Open up my Oh, you may stay seated, or stay standing just for a moment, sorry. Hello, this is the time in our service when we say hello, and those of you that are visiting don't know that. So, hello to all of you, hello to you from the Cove that are here visiting, and hello to those of you on live stream. If you're new to our church congregation and you would like more information about our congregation to get better connected, we have these welcome cards in the pew backs, and you can fill these out and put them in the offering plate when it goes by. Now, for those of you in the sanctuary, I encourage you to take a few minutes together to say hello to one another, preferably somebody you did not come to church with, and pass the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. Amen.
Let's try that again. Okay. In a moment, we're going to sing our confession of sin. Sin is not our original condition. Sin is what obscures us from who we originally are in God and keeps us from God. So that's why we confess sin. It's to strip away the false parts of ourself so we come to the core that's beloved by God. So we're going to sing that, and then we're going to affirm our pardon by reciting probably the best known verse or verses in the whole Bible, John 3:16.
Spirit, lift me from this wasteland. as the morning calls to light the dark in me.
Thank you, worship team. Now we're going to recite John 3:16 for our assurance of pardon. Let's do that in unison. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Amen. We are beloved of the Father who sent his Son. All right, I have the pleasure now of introducing, once again, Mark Labberton. And you guys don't have ties, but I do, and there's a reason. This is a Scottish Black Watch tie. So I don't remember exactly where or when I bought it, but it had to be in Scotland, because I remember I brought this tie all the way from Scotland. And it's kind of a puny, funny-looking little tie, but it reminds me of that beautiful time. We met some dear people when we landed in Scotland. We'd never been overseas very much. And Tim and Carrie Dearborn just sort of took us by the hand and said, hey, you should meet these people. And you should. And it just turned out that we went to the same church in the Church of Scotland, which is Mama Church for us Presbyterians. And they befriended us, and they had us over. They had the gift of hospitality. And so after a few years, we were about ready to leave, and they said, hey, we've got some friends we'd like you to meet. So we trekked up to their place. I think at that time they had this little house way out towards the Scottish Highlands, and in the dark of night with rain and all kinds of weather, just like we've been having the last few weeks. Imagine that was summer. That's kind of what it's like to live in northeastern Scotland. And we walked in, we trekked in, sat down, and we met these delightful people. And it was Mark and Janet Labberton. That was 35 years ago. And so then I saw Mark then for the second time Friday night. And he made me feel like I was a friend and we'd known each other. But that's not the reality. The reality is that Mark has not only given us tremendous insight into this, the scripture and the theology, he's given us himself. So, you know, he's not perfect, but Mark, you're credible. You're credible. I mean, that's what the world's looking for us to walk our talk. And that's why your messages not only hit home, but they're credible. So I'll stop palavering and just come on up and share with us now, Mark, would you? And thank you, Dan, for bringing him here. Dan and Allie, thanks for getting Mark here for us.
It's very wonderful to be here. I love this weekend and the chance to be with many of you on Friday and Saturday morning, and then to be here again with the rest of you and others that may have come to be part of this time of worship. I love First Presbyterian Church of Santa Rosa. I've been here a number of times in my past, and while it's been a while, it's a place that leaves its mark on you, and I certainly experienced that. The times I came here to preach or to teach, lead classes, sometimes related to New College Berkeley, sometimes just independent things that you were doing, I really loved all of those connections. And so thank you, Dan, for your very warm welcome 35 years hence. Oh my gosh, I'm sure I was just a toddler at that time. I also want to say thank you to Dan Baumgartner. Dan and Ann Baumgartner have became very close friends to Janet and me during the time that Dan was at Hollywood Press and I was serving at Fuller. So during that time, we found a kinship in a way that is just was a very significant gift during that season and has continued to be so. So I really am delighted for this little mini love fest that's happening between these congregations this weekend. So I just want to encourage that, fan that all I can, and say that's a really good thing and figure out whatever that means. But whatever it does mean, may it long thrive and be repeated in various ways over time. Let's take a moment just to pray for God's Spirit to move as we seek to hear his word. Oh, holy God, how grateful we are that we are here together in this place, two congregations and others that are probably visiting. In your spirit, may you welcome us, and may we welcome you into our hearts. And now as we attend to your word, may we welcome your word to be a word of life to us. A word of life. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Understand, it was C.S. Lewis who said that preaching is mild-mannered people exhorting mild-mannered people to be more mild-mannered. Pathetically, that is probably true, more times than we would ever want to acknowledge. But this text that we're looking at this morning in Matthew's Gospel is anything but mild. You would be completely misreading the Sermon on the Mount if you didn't actually hear it as the shocking news that it is. As Annie Dillard has said, if we understood the power that we are dealing with, we would need to put seatbelts in the pews and hand out crash helmets as people come in the church. What she's naming is that this is actually meant to be a tremendous reorientation and regrounding and reenactment of what it means to be human in the world. And Jesus gives us in the Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5 through 7 of Matthew, his first major body of teaching. There are five in Matthew's Gospel. This is the first and most well-known. And it is the section of the Gospel in which Jesus first lays out the biggest picture of what life in the kingdom of God is actually looking like. It's going to reorder everything. It's going to turn things upside down and inside out. It's going to cause us to have to reframe our own humanity to understand power in entirely new ways. It's going to recast how we understand our history and our future. It's going to recast how we see friends, neighbors, even enemies, and how in all of those cases we are called in the kingdom to live a life of extraordinary, radical, unexpected love. That's the great invitation, and it is anything but mild-mannered. And it is not for people who will simply receive it in a mild-mannered way and go on being more mild-mannered. It's meant to actually cause us to live into a new creation in which we are not fantastically hoping for something that we're trying to create ourselves. No, we are actually living into the reality of who God is, what God has done in Jesus Christ, and what it is that we are here to celebrate, to honor, and to reflect in our lives. Jesus comes to the end of this great body of teaching at the end of chapter 7 with a very familiar parable, which probably many of us, if not all of us, have heard at some point or another. And it won't be found in the book of Daniel. You'll have to turn to Matthew 7 for that. The end of the sermon, in a very well-known section of text, he says this. First, a warning. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the ones who do the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and make food for potlucks in your name and do many deeds of power in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away. He goes on to say this, everyone then, however, by contrast to that, who hear the words and don't do it, he says instead this, a word of life. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain fell and the floods came and beat against that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. Now, when Jesus had finished saying all these things, the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes. Jesus is sobered by the human condition, to say the least. He actually understands who we are and who we're not. He understands that there's always people in a crowd who might say, yeah, yeah, I'm for that guy. I'm for what he just said. But then we just go on and do whatever we want to do anyway, as though none of that had ever happened. And Jesus here is saying, don't be like those people. No, what I'm calling you to is life. But to live life in the kingdom of God, you have to actually build and enact a life. You have to actually do something, not just confess something, not just hold it in your mind, feel it in your heart. You actually need to enact a life of faith. This is a life that is meant to be built, and it's built by acts and communities of love that perform the gospel. What is the mission, the common mission of your two churches? That you are called to perform the gospel in the city of Santa Rosa and with and for one another and for people of all kinds who live in this city, this county, this vicinity, and wherever you may go. You are meant to be the part of the wind of the Spirit, the aroma of Christ, the blessing of people who may be starving for some evidence of goodness and kindness and gentleness and truth and clarity about what it really means to be a human being, and by God's grace, what it means to become a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus is pointing to. And he's not interested in something else, as in hearing the word and just saying, good sermon. That's anathema, really. He's saying, no, what we want is for people to actually live the truth. The number one critique of the church in the surrounding world, and sometimes inside, but certainly from the surrounding voices, is what? That the church is hypocritical. Hello, can we say that together? Hypocritical. I, Mark Labberton, am hypocritical. We can be hypocritical. We can easily say something and fail to do it. That reality is not an evidence of the kingdom of God. And I'm going to, at the risk of sounding like I'm affirming myself, borrow back Dan's word that I believe he borrowed from me, which is credibility. What Jesus is calling us to is not perfection, as though it is a human instrumentation. I need to perfectly live the Christian life. It's that I need to live a credible Christian life. That what I say and what I do, what we say and what we do, is actually one whole. And the world around us is just saying, well, you say these things. I didn't say them. This is your vocabulary. You say there's a God of love and grace and mercy and kindness and goodness and justice. You say that's what you believe. So now just show me what that looks like in real time. How does it actually show up in the world that you're people who confess that there is a God of those characters and that you seek to be people identified with that God? Just show me that with credibility, not perfection. I'm fine with you sometimes failing and stumbling. Anybody and everybody does that. Just show up with credibility. That's what Jesus is calling the church to be. When that critique, especially poignant in this very era that we're living in, where the church is fighting itself, failing to live its own identity, rejecting one another in droves and in tribes and in ideologies that fly across the spectrum, in that world, the church is meant to actually be instead a peculiar community. We are wholly unlike one another. We didn't come together because we are like each other or necessarily that we like each other. We came together because we belong to Jesus Christ, who is the one who alone can make us one. And it's in that context that we are able together, in the failure and stumbling and challenging way that it requires, to actually become people who live and enact the gospel in the world. That's it. That's our mission. It's not abstract. It's not theoretical. It's not distant. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount is not a depiction of the distant future. It's a description of what life is meant to start becoming now in the ordinary places that we live. Sitting in those pews, going home to your favorite chair, watching whatever you're going to watch on the television, doing whatever you're doing on the internet, going or not going to work, paying attention to your children or not, whatever it is that's going to be going on for you, it's right in those spaces that the reality of the kingdom of God is just meant to show up in really doable tasks, lives, relationships, love, kindness, again, justice. All of that is part of what an ordinary Christian life and community is meant to display. Having said that, then the writer of the gospel says, Now, when Jesus had finished saying that this is the kind of life that we're meant to build, a house built by doing the truth, not just affirming it, then the crowds were astonished, the text says, for he taught as one who had authority. That word in Matthew's gospel is a somewhat deliberate technical term that's used a number of places throughout Matthew, and every time it appears as a way of saying Jesus is the one who does and who says and does the same thing. Our voice and our touch, in the language of Max Dupree, are actually brought together. What we say and what we do is actually one thing. How astounding it would be if it was said of the church. You know, you just don't want to go near a church if you're looking for people that are inconsistent. Because, you know, they say one thing, and it just turns out they actually do it. Would that not just be an astounding, astounding rap on the street? Yeah, those people that go to church, they actually live there, what they say. That's disorienting. No one lives what they say, except we're meant to be characterized by living what we say. But of course, the challenge is always what happens when you come down from the mountain. The very next part of Matthew goes this way. When Jesus had come down from the mountain, and it always is about what happens down, not up. Down, he comes down from the mountain. Great crowds followed him, and there was a leper who came to him and knelt before him saying, Lord, if you choose, you can make me clean. Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him and said, I do choose. Be made clean. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed, and then Jesus said to him, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. What's happening in this moment is that anyone who would understand the Jewish culture of that moment would realize that a leper was something of a kind of icon of how to find the purity that the temple and the law requires violated. In other words, you do not want to touch a leper. You do not want a leper to touch you. You don't want to come close to them. They were unclean. And they were meant to walk through the world wherever they were occupying space and saying over and again, unclean, 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 as a warning to anyone who might come close to them, to say, stay away from me. And now, with this unbelievable courage and neediness and honesty, he simply cries out to Jesus, not saying unclean, but saying, you could choose to make me clean. The text said Jesus did choose. One of the great challenges when we come down from the mountain, when we leave worship, gathered as we are, and scatter to all the places that we will be this week and every other week to follow, is really whether we will actually do what the good teaching on the mount actually offered. And now it's, okay, the very first thing is, oops, no, I know exactly, Jesus might be saying to himself, I know exactly what the law requires of me. Avoid, 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 warning, don't come near, this is not the person to encounter. And now as that warning goes off and everything is blasting, don't go near, Jesus goes near. Near enough to touch, near enough to hear, near enough to warrant, near enough to understand, near enough to internalize a person who we might think of as a person who might stain him. Now, you and I don't live in a world with probably a lot of contact with people who have leprosy, but we do live in a world where lots of people we think might stain us. Isn't this partly how sociology works? I know my brand, I know my people. Middle school is the ground where we learn all of this. We learn to assess the finest differences that say, my people, not my people. No, my people, no, not my people. And we go through our lives learning how to seamlessly pull this off as though we're just being polite. Actually, we're not. We're sorting, constantly sorting. We're perceiving, we're naming, we're calling them in, out, them, us. We're distinguishing. We're walking another direction. We're trying to find something else to do. When those people are over there doing their thing, I'm going to make sure I'm going to be over here. And if they don't hold the same views that I do, and if they don't confess faith in the same way I do, or if they don't have the same habits of life that I have, then really they are those people. And we're really good sorters. And we don't even have to talk about it. We just sort. We walk through the world sortingly. It's just an extraordinary act of sociology. And hidden in that is all sorts of stuff that's preloaded about who we think is warranting our attention or our love or our compassion, who might stain us. We don't want association with them because they're really those people and we're these kinds of people. It might be out of a kind of sticky righteousness, or it might be out of some kind of miserly spirit. It might be out of fear and anxiety. It might come from all kinds of things. But whatever those things are, they can leave us completely stripped of an understanding of what it means to walk in the world with the kind of freedom that Jesus walks into the world. He walks into the world not anxious about faithful observation and perfect obedience to the law. Instead, he walks in the freedom of the God of the law, who loves lepers, who loves people who might stain him. And he will ultimately take our stain on himself. As we come to this table, it screams, this is a God who loves those who stain him, with no need that he deserves such a thing, but simply because he wants to be with us. He says to you and me, I'm walking among you, people who stain me with your sin. I want to be with you. I want to heal you. I want to encourage you. I want to strengthen you. I want to fortify you. I want to help you live life in the real world. That is the vocation. So how are we doing with people who might stain us? I was saying to the groups that had been together on Saturday morning and Friday night, you know, we might just say, well, if the gold standard that Jesus provides us with here is that we're really meant to love our enemies, which is about where we're going to go, then we could just start by people who might stain us. Or people, in other words, who might just irritate us, who are just different from us. Like we could just be associated with people who are just bothersome. Do you know any people who bother you? Are they sitting next to you right now? Might they have come from the same bed as you woke up this morning? Are they people that live in your house? Are they part of your job context? Are they your neighbor? Are the people down the street who don't do things the way you think they should be done, actually their yard is offensive, enough to keep me distant from them, because you know they don't tend things the way I think they should be tended? Friends, we are meant to be God's peculiar people, who, unlike a world that lives its sociology sorted by economics and race and gender, by power and powerlessness, by resources, by beauty, by health, by age, in a world where all of that sorting is endlessly going on, we are meant to be the people who are not the sorters. We don't hold sorting categories, raising up some people and lowering other people. How do we learn a new sociology that is the sociology of the kingdom, where people who are like us and unlike us, people who like us and don't like us, people who may even be our enemies, how do we walk into that world and give demonstrated evidence of a God like the God that Jesus has been revealing to the disciples just so far in the Gospel of Matthew, let alone all the way to the cross and the resurrection? The next section of this chapter moves seamlessly to this. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, appealing to him and saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed and in terrible distress. Remember, a centurion, a Roman official, a representative of the oppressive regime that holds Israel down and defines everything that Israel considers to be the most fearsome and the most important to obey. The one who, like a Nazi official, arrive amidst the holy gathering of God's people. It's not exactly a welcome sight. And there, this centurion officer just walks in, not as an act of hostility, but as an act of vulnerable need, crying out, not for himself, but for his servant, and says, I have this servant who's desperately in need of your healing. And Jesus says, I'll come and heal him. He says, no, no, no. He says to Jesus, you don't need to come and heal. I understand how authority works. I'm a person under authority. I say the word and people do what I say. So you can likewise do the same. And Jesus pauses the action and more or less says to everybody, did you all hear that? that the Nazi guy just walked in the office, into the gathering. This centurion official among us is calling now on me, not even to go, but to just do the word and my servant would be healed. And Jesus says, do you know, I have not heard faith like that in all of Israel. And there are people who consider themselves part of God's house who will actually be found in the outer darkness. And there are people that in the outer darkness who will actually be found in the household of God because they are living this same kind of faith. So the question becomes, what does our faith do in relationship to enemies? Not just people who might stain us, but people who are really hostile toward us. Nowhere in the Bible, including all of Jesus' teaching, does he say anything naive as, there are no such things as enemies. Oh no, there really are enemies. There really are people who seek to do us or others great pain or suffering or challenge, oppression of different kinds, injustice of different kinds. No, there really, really are people like that. Now the question becomes, what will you do as you relate to people like that? I do want to say when I'm talking about this that I want to be cautious about the fact that we live in a world where gender and sexual abuse and harassment is really far more common than we want it to be. I do not believe in people staying in marriages in which there is sexual abuse and sexual harassment. I don't see that that's what I'm talking about. So I'm wanting to send sort of a warning up to just say, don't hear me saying any and all suffering needs to be tolerated and any and all enemies need to be proximate. That's not what's happening in this text. In this text, it's not that kind of power abuse, but it is about political repression and oppression and about people who are actually seeking to control and manipulate by power the reality of what is happening in their world. That's exactly what Rome was doing in the first century. And now Jesus, encountering a person who represents that sort of power, hears it, honors it, lifts it up as an exemplar and says, people who exercise faith like that are better than the people in faith inside the household of God. How does all that get sorted out in our lives? We live in a culture of people who stain us, or we think stain us, we fear stain us, and we also definitely live in a world with enemies. Real people, real violence, real vulnerability, a world where there's really a lot at risk, where it's understandable that we have fears of various kinds. And it's also the case that Jesus wants us to find freedom and life to give to an enemy. Read the Sermon on the Mount again this afternoon if you have a chance to do that. Again, it's not a big deal. Even Gentiles, that would be us, even Gentiles can love people who like them. That's not a big achievement. It's really the question of, can we move beyond our sociological categories, our fears, anxieties, and even those who may feel threatening to us, to find a way of living in their presence? Let me close with this story. It's a story that I've written about, and maybe some of you may have heard, but I want to be sure that you hear it, because I think it is a story that, still to this day as I tell it, is astounding to me. It's about a woman named Doris. She was part of our church in Berkeley. At the time of the story, she was about 86, 87 years old. A tall, very elegant, fine-boned, older, beautiful Presbyterian woman. The kind of Presbyterian woman of her generation that would probably have had her hair done every Friday at 11, right? I want you to kind of get in your body. That's who we're talking about. Elegant Doris, beautifully coiffed, gutsy, but beautifully coiffed. Looks frail, she's got a lot going. So one day in worship, I hear that something terrible has happened to Doris as she's coming into church on that day. And I don't understand what it is, except it sounded violent and it sounded like it was really a very significant thing. I'd heard that she had gone home. So right after the service, I rushed to her apartment, feeling like maybe this is my shot at actually being Doris's pastor, because she had been actually my pastor so many times over the years. But finally, I'm going to show up for Doris and try to be whatever helped her, whatever it is that's happened. Doris, I say, I understand something terrible's happened. Can we talk about it. And so she invited me and we sat down and she said, oh gosh, you know, I am still a little bit flustered, but yeah, this really unusual thing happened. I was just coming to church. I'd parked in that place. You know that place where I always park? I know that place where you always park. Well, I just parked in that place and I was reaching across the driver's seat to the other seat where, in fact, there were those nut muffins. You know those nut muffins that I often bring? Well, it was just that I was just trying to get the nut muffins. That's the thing. And suddenly, I was struck from behind, pushed across the console and into the passenger seat. And the person that did this just grabbed the keys that were in my hand, put them in the ignition, and took off. And I said, what are we doing? What's happening? Who are you? Note to self, if you're being kidnapped, ask their name. Who are you? Turned out he was Jesse. Jesse, what are we doing? We're going to your bank. Why are we going to the bank? Because I need money. Why do you need money? Because I'm a drug addict. And she's going, well, this is terrible. He coerces her and threatens her in such a way that she surrenders her code. He goes to the bank machine. He puts in the card, gets a certain amount of money out, comes back to the car. Jesse, have you done this to other people? This is really terrible. Do you understand that it's really not good to treat people this way? And do you also understand that this is a really terrible thing to be a drug addict? I mean, like, you really shouldn't be a drug addict. It's destroying your life. And right at this moment, it's sort of destroying my life. Like, what is this? This is terrible that we're doing this. Next stop, another cash load. Next stop, another cash load. Eventually, that comes to an end. And finally, he's about to now leave her. And she says, Jesse, I can't even get out of the car to go back to the passenger side. So he comes around to the driver's side. So he comes around to the passenger side, escorts her around to the driver's seat, helps her in, lifts up her legs to put them into the car, takes the seatbelt and puts it across her, puts the keys in the ignition, and then leans down and gives her a kiss on the cheek. Jesse, I'm going to pray that you get caught, because this is terrible. You need to be in jail. You're a crook. This is awful. Secondly, you really need a good drug rehab program. He goes, no, I've been on drug rehab. No, I understand. There's good drug rehab programs and bad. You need to be in a really good drug rehab program. And thirdly, you need Jesus. I will help you with that. But the other parts, we've got to get you in jail. And we've got to get you in the right program. And I'm going to come and talk to you about Jesus. I said, Doris, I just can't even believe this story just happened. Maybe you could pray for the trauma I'm experiencing as you share your trauma with me, because I'm so traumatized by the thought that all of this has just happened to you. And so she prays for me, and I do actually also pray for, I pray for her. I'm the wimp pastor on the side going, I can't even believe the story I just heard, but it was Doris after all. So no surprise, 2 weeks later, got in for a lineup. Sure enough, there was Jesse, third from the left, knew just who he was. Eventually, I go with her to the jury, or to the trial, where she's going to testify against Jesse. And she gets into the witness box, and she more or less says, so hey, Jesse, it's me, Doris. Remember, we had that time in the car. And really, everything that this, he's being charged with, all of it, that's exactly what happened. It was just as bad as it was represented to be. And he should be found guilty. So let's just go right for that. He should definitely be found guilty. This was a terrible thing, and he should be stopped, and he should be in jail. Now, two further things, Judge. One is he needs a really good drug rehab program. And they had a little tete-a-tete. And then he needs Jesus. I'm going to take responsibility for that. But if you can take care of getting him in jail and in a good drug rehab program, I think we're set. So, sure enough, he's convicted, in jail, is in Berkeley, close enough that she can visit. And for the next 6 months, pretty much every week, every other week, she went and spent about an hour with Jesse, getting to know him, his story, why he was a drug addict, how he had become a drug addict, what it meant to somehow try to seek rehab, and of the life that God wanted to give to Jesse, to restore to Jesse, which the tale of his life had undone in so many ways. What do you do with enemies? Jesus says, well, you love them. You see them. I seldom ever heard Doris talk about that story as though she was the victim. She says, it's really a terrible thing that happened to Jesse. all these things that happened in his life, and they all contributed to a mess, and he didn't have the resources or people around him that helped him, and it was just a disaster. But now he's got some good resources. He is in a good drug rehab program, and he's hearing about the God who loves Jesse in all of his messiness, even when he's kidnapping me. Now, I am not like Doris. I've sometimes thought, you know, some people a number of years ago used to wear WWJD bracelets. I sort of would be fine with a bracelet that was just WWDD. What would Doris do? Like, that would put me a lot further down the road of being a disciple than I might normally think. I would think that's inhuman, that's bizarre, that's just weird. Like, how could this dear older lady with her hair done on Fridays at 11 somehow find the capacity to be able to love a Jesse who actually takes her hostage, steals from her, and runs off? Because it just turns out that in the life of Doris, her heart had been filled with the love and grace of God. It had been tested and tried through years of teaching in Oakland Public Schools. She had been friends of students whose families and lives were riddled with the reality of all this. She did bring a lot to that game, and though it appeared that she was one thing, she brought everything to it. We may not bring the experience that Doris had, but we are meant to bring the reality of a living God who actually dwells in us and among us and calls us into this new reality of life and of hope. Amen. That's what matters about your churches. That's why your congregations being thriving places of communion with God and with each other, focused in the scriptures, centered in Jesus Christ, lived out in the world, is actually just the ordinary witness of what Christian people. Doris would be the last person to think herself a Christian hero. Like, no way would she accept that. She was just trying to be a lover of people in the name of Christ, even when it came in really unexpected, shocking, disorienting, vulnerable ways. So the good news, Jesus says, is this. I actually don't want you to just say amen to my sermon. I want you to say amen, he says at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, by living what I've just taught. And that's what it looks like in the ministry of Jesus, stainers, enemies. What is it going to look like for us? What does it already look like? Thanks for what God is already doing in your lives. But as you look forward, what yet more does God have to fill you with, to assure you with, to set you free, to be a person who lives the reality of the kingdom of God? Now that church, anybody would want to be a part of. Lord, by your grace, we cry out to you. As the needy, vulnerable, partial people that we are, we're going to come in a few moments to this table. And it's a table that says, how proximate are you to people who might stain you? Well, you've taken our stains on yourself. How proximate are you to people who are your enemies? This close. Close enough to be injured and crucified and willing even to offer your very life. These are not theoretical lessons that we find at this table. They are embodied enactments of a tangible love that the God of the universe in Jesus Christ, in ordinary spaces and lives, is wanting to intersect with, to nourish us, to remind and fill us with the food of our salvation and of our hope and of your reign. The God who reigns is the God who was crucified. The God of glory is the God with pierced hands, even in eternity. This is the God who says, come to me, all you who are weary and are heavy laden, and I will give you my rest. O God, may we eat and drink today in fellowship with you, and therefore in fellowship with one another, who we come to know and love and serve beside as we enact the body of Christ, the kingdom of God, for Santa Rosa and far beyond. In Jesus' name.
Jesus said, "Come to me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. You will find rest for your souls. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. No one who comes to me will I cast out." This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to come forward and receive the gifts which he has prepared.
It never fails to amaze me that on the night Jesus was betrayed, his last night, what he found important was not to hold a press conference, was not to make a speech, but it was to gather with just a small group of good friends that he loved and share a meal together. And so it was that Jesus gathered those friends, took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for your sake. Do this in remembrance of me."
And on the same night, in much the same way, he took the cup saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. And every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God." I would now like to invite our communion servers to come forward and take their places to serve communion. And today, if you would like to receive communion, you'll come forward row by row down the center aisle and go off to either side. We do ask that you put your hands out and the communion server will place the bread into your hands. They have gloves on. And then you may take a cup that's on either side as well. If you need gluten-free communion, there is gluten-free communion on the tables or off to the side, depending on which way you come up. And I'd just like to remind our servers to welcome our gluten-free people as well with those words, not just the people that take the regular bread. Sometimes we forget. If you are wanting to have communion, but are unable to come forward for any reason, please, you can stay in your seat and just raise your hand. And we have, it looks like, Linda in the back, and she will bring communion to you. You do not have to rush. You can take your time and receive the elements at your own pace. There are trash cans on either side for you to put your cups in, or you may take your communion back to your seat if that's more comfortable for you. Now taste and see that the Lord is good. You are invited to come forward and receive.
Let's pray together. God, you are a good God. And at least at some moments, Lord, we know how much we need you, and we know how thirsty we are for you and more of you, and we know how hungry we are for you and more of you. And this morning, Lord, my heart is full. You have met us in the power of your Holy Spirit. You have met us in your word and scripture. You have met us in our worship. You have met us in our time with each other. You have nourished our souls, and you have reminded us of your love, cross, and resurrection. You are a good God, and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, let's continue our worship this morning by returning to God. Some of our resources, if the ushers would please come forward.
Join us. Mm-hmm.
the other one?
Okay, that's better. Thank you, worship team. Before I give the benediction, I just want to say that we do have people down here. If you would like to be prayed for or someone to talk with, just come down in front after worship. Also, get to know your brothers and sisters. You probably don't know each other as well as you normally do after our 10:30 service. So there's some snacks in the hallway, and if it's a little crowded, you can just sort of push your way down into Ingram Hall and just feel free to hang around and to browse. And also, Tim Stafford wanted me to mention, please pray for Dusty and Sherry Ellington. They're missionaries supported by this congregation. They're attempting to go back this week. They're going to fly back to Beirut if all goes well. But you know how tenuous things are. And of course, pray for the peace of Jerusalem as we're commanded in Scripture, and for the people there. So now receive the benediction. In a world that's sometimes dark and bland, you are called to be salt and light. Tomorrow's Monday morning, and you have the family and work and all the things of life to deal with. But know that the one that abides in you is greater than the one that's in the world. So go forth and boldly be salt and light. Light in the name of Jesus. Amen.